ये भी कर सकते Good morning, all. All the participants are requested, please be unmuted during the session. Be muted during the session. Whenever you required, then you unmute after the session. Thank you.
Welcome, sir. सर आपण सुरू करायचं का?
थँक यू. हो, काय हरकत नाही, सुरू करायला.
ओके. देर इज नो एंड टू एज्युकेशन. लर्निंग इज अ लाईफ लॉंग प्रोसेस. इन करंट पॅन्डेमिक ऑल्सो कुड नॉट स्टॉप आर हॅबिट ऑफ लर्निंग. And this webinar is part of that learning process. Today we have with us our respected principal, Dr. R.M. Bise sir, IQAC coordinator, Dr. A.S. Raut sir, today's enthusiastic speaker, Dr. Sharad Lande, assistant vice president of R&D Reliance Industries Limited, Mumbai, professor and head of chemistry department, Dr. G.V. Korpe. Also we have with us Dr. Nakte sir, assistant professor of Bajaj College of Science, distinguished faculties, all teaching staff of chemistry department, research scholars, PG and UG students from different colleges and universities as well. I'm Dr. Mamta T. Sangole, assistant professor from Department of Chemistry, wishing you a very pleasant morning. Welcome you all and thank you all for joining us today's webinar on Catalysis for Sustainable Chemistry organized by Department of Chemistry, Sri Shivaji College of Art, Commerce, Science and Akola. Hope I am audible.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Let us all join hands to seek prayer and blessings from the God to start this event and also seek blessing from our founder president of this institution, Dr. Punjab Rao alias Bhausaheb Deshmukh. Now I take this honor to introduce our esteemed guest and dynamic speaker, Dr. Sharad Lande, Assistant Vice President of R&D Reliance Industries Limited, Mumbai. Today, he is a well-known personality, as always excelling in his field and has put lot of feathers on his hat. Dr. Lande has did his MSc from Shivaji College of Akola in the year of 2000 and PhD in chemistry from ICT Mumbai with Professor Dr. G.D. Adav. Under the guidance of Professor G.D. Adav, he is a former VC of ICT Mumbai as well as he is a well-known chemist of India. Dr. Lande is a recipient of Gujarat Ambuja Cement-based PhD Thesis Award at ICT Mumbai. He did his postdoctoral research at the Center for Catalysis Research and Innovation at University of Ottawa at Canada and worked on palladium-supported catalyst for carbonylation reactions with heterogeneous catalyst system for dimethyl carbonate synthesis for 2 years. Also, he has joined Reliance R&D Center in the year of 2007 and currently working as a youngest assistant vice president and have more than 18 years research experience in the field of heterogeneous catalysis for hydrocarbon conversion. At Reliance, he is involved in commercialization of lead alumina catalyst for dehydrogenation of N-paraffin and relax catalyst for nitrogen purification at Tate Hazaria, commercialization of GTL feed at lab Vadodara, he is also working on development of novel catalyst for OOCs removal from petroleum industry and refinery streams, adsorptive purification of various streams and root cause of ethylene oxide catalyst. Dr. Sharad has 30 international publications and 25 patents in his credits. He was a guide for 4 MTech and 1 PhD thesis project on industrial catalysis and won several technical excellence awards in Reliance. He has delivered many invited talks on various forums and likes to motivate especially students. He is a reviewer of various reputed peer-reviewed scientific journals, and he has membership of various professional bodies. I'm glad to quote that he is also a CDC member of our college. Okay, so with this word, I would like to invite our speaker, Dr. Sharad Lande, for his talk.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. Mamta Sangole, madam.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, first of all, I would like to thank the Department of Chemistry staff and the principal, Dr. Pise, Dr. Korpe, and all the member. With the naman to our Jabra Deshmukh, who has initiated the Shivaji Education Society for the welfare of the students who are in our Vidarbha region, to get the opportunity and to learn and grow in our area. So just I am attaching my presentation. Can you see the slides, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, just one. Okay, so once again, very good morning to all of you. And welcome to this webinar, dear respected all the students, professor, and maybe the members from other professions to take on this webinar to benefit all basically the students who are working in the chemistry and related areas. So today I'm going to talk something on the catalysis for sustainable chemistry. So this is just a disclaimer, whatever the views I will present here, this is my view. Today I'm going to cover briefly on the industrial catalysis and measure the energy security, health security, environmental protections, and some case studies what we are doing in Reliance as a R&D scientist. And then what are the future perspective for sustainability, where our researcher or students can work and they can make the futures. So this is a very broad area, so it will be difficult to cover in next 1 hour, but I will give some idea and some challenges where we are and where we are going in terms of as a research community. So if you see in terms of the inventions which has happened due to chemistry basically, which has enabled the modern world. First invention was the discovery of the penicillin. Alexander Fleming, who has discovered this penicillin in 1928. And the use of this penicillin was discovered by 1939 by Howard. He worked long for all that. And this was among the first drugs which is effective against multiple bacterial infections. So that chemistry has started with that vision for this human cause, basically, I will say. After that, Haber process, which has come for ammonia synthesis, because in our farming center, plant need the nitrogen, and major limiting factor is the agriculture and availability. So German chemist Fritz Haber and Karl Bosch, who has worked long way by combining hydrogen and nitrogen to make the urea, so to enhance our productivity, which can fit to around 130 billions of our Indian population, which is as a crop fertilizer. Then the world, with movement of the world, polyethylene has come, polymer plastic, what we are today using. Without that, it is very difficult to survive. So that has come in 1819. And that is also incidental, accidental discovery of this polymer, because ICI was working on something, some polymerization reactions. There they found this type of polyethylene, so around 80 million tons made by this process, with Ziegler-Natta. going ahead, this discovery by Russell Marker, who was an organic chemist, discovering Mexican and this contraceptive pills, that was basically progesterone in single step he has discovered. So that was the first development which has changed the world in terms of the contraceptive pill. Then liquid crystal display. All mobiles and laptops today we are seeing LCD basically. That is due to the invention of the chemist basically. So that is basically diphenyl cyanoderivatives, which are discovered in 1972. And then George has discovered this. And now whatever the things we are seeing in display, liquid display, or the mobile charger, that is his invention. So everything, this has a major invention, this has happened. And inventions are very few in the chemist if you see. But that invention, what it leads basically, that leads to many innovations. So that, can you please make yourself mute? Yeah. So all these inventions, which has converted into innovations, many inventions, which has impacted our society. Now coming to, can you imagine the life without chemistry? Now those who are working in the chemistry or the students who are learning, now chemistry we are learning from high schools. So we know the importance of chemistry. So we start with the growing the farmers, growing the different crops and the vegetables. And when we do the breakfast and any for our survival, so there we need a lot of urea. So this urea we are producing by ammonia. Around 130 million metric ton urea we are producing from CO2. There CO2 is also utilizing. So that is a major impact of the chemistry on our farming sector. And every day in the morning we are using toothpaste. That also has the chemicals. Without chemicals, we can't make the toothpaste, which is this calcium-based, fluoride-based. Apart from that, we are using different type of soaps and detergent in our daily life. So that is basically the surfactant, a linear alkyl benzene detergent. So that is also made with the help of the chemistry. Various types of cloth, the polyester industry has come. Reliance is the major producer of the polyester. So that also has the change the world, and all the polyester we are making by polyethylene terephthalate. So that also, which is impacting our daily life. Moving ahead, the various drugs, which is a invention of the chemistry. Now various diseases are there, but against that, a lot of invention and research has done to discover the new drugs. So that is happened due to the invention of the research. And the one area is the PET bottles and is pure water. We are fighting to get the pure water in major sector of cities and villages. So purification of water is a major issue. So there also we are using different filters, activate carbon to purify the waters. And the bottles also we are making with the help of polyethylene terephthalate. Then the fuel, basically the major energy sector, where our major consumption more than that in India, energy security in terms of that oil. So that is also due to the gasoline productions by various chemical reactions. And then the tires, rubber material, that is synthetic rubber we are making by SBR, so styrene butadiene and rubber. So that tires also the raw material of the due to the chemistry. Different toys, what the kids are playing in our home, that is also invention of various type of HDP, polyethylene, polypropylene, different types of the polymers basically used to make this poly. Different types of cosmetics in industry, that also was a big market all over the world. So that all are the basically based on the chemical. And the LCD display, already I explained you, all the displays, mobile, right now the communication, which are possible to connect all of us due to these inventions. And major important role is now the mask. Right now we are going to be a very tough situation in COVID. Again, the second lot has come. So with protection, basically the mask is a protecting to us. That is also based on the polyester and polypropylene. Coming to the hand sanitizer, that is also alcohol based, which is surviving us in today's situation, which is helping us to get rid of this COVID and keep healthy. And last is a COVID vaccine, which is also the due to the chemistry research, biochemistry, microbiology. A lot of teamwork is there, but basically the chemical reactions which are happening to make the different molecule against different diseases. So all this is happening due to the continuous research innovation throughout the world and involvement of many scientists, not only chemistry, it is a biochemistry, microbiology, biochemistry, biotechnologies. So it is all work is there from physics, chemistry, mathematics, everything is there to develop all the process and all the projects. Coming to the structure of our chemical industry, if you see our chemical industry, most of the thing crude oil we are importing from the Middle East. And then when it comes to our India, we are making the different fuels, energy, oils, gas for our demand. And then transportation and heating, we are making that. Out of that, some is going in feedstock, some is going in commodity chemicals, polymers, specialty fine chemicals, and pharmaceuticals. Apart from now, there is a natural gas discovery also. We have a different gas we are getting, ethane, methane. So we are using that as a fuel now, and we are making different chemicals from methane by cracking. So that also alternative source we are looking. Why this chemical industry is important for India? If you see Indian chemical industries, it is divided into various sectors, you know, which is helping to grow our economy, which is around 7%, and indirect contribution is around 60%. And its distribution is textile, petroleum, chemical, pharma, polymers, basic chemicals, and automotive. And if you see, there is an 11% share of total imports, and it is around 160 billion industry, and almost 12% share of total exports. So you can see the impact of this chemistry on our society and our life. Coming to the current Indian scenario, where we are as of now, if you see. So in terms of energy security, there is a major challenge for our population and next maybe 20, 30 years, our next future generation. So currently, if you see, we are importing almost 87% oil in 2009 to meet our energy demand. This is total costing around more than 100 billion. And which is out of that contributing 40% to the transport section. So you can see the energy demand and utilization. So transport sector is a major energy utilization. Apart from that, challenge is import dependency. We are importing various material and component for manufacturing vehicles, automotive, pharmaceutical, API, various drugs, intermediate we are importing from China basically. And that import is going more than 31%. So that is also spending is more than 18 billion in 2019. Coming to the major, one more challenge is carbon emissions. We are fighting with the pollutions. And if you see, as India, it is the fourth largest CO2 emitter, transportation, which is coming from 10% CO2 generating from transportation, which is contributing to emission in India. So these are the basically challenges we are working, our government is working, all the labs are working to overcome that. And we are finding out basically the different alternatives to meet the demand. Now coming to our topic, catalysis. For the student, just I will give some basics on the catalysis. Those who are new, maybe you heard during your BSc, MSc, it is catalysis used widely in various industries. So something just to refresh your knowledge. Basically, the catalyst term, which was discovered in 1835 by Jacob. What he mentioned that in the molecule, beside affinity, a new force is operative, but that is a catalytic force. Apart from that, what is the job this catalyst do? Basically, it accelerates the chemical reactions by small quantity of the substance when you put in the reaction without changing the rate of the reaction, without changing the molecule productivity. Accelerate the thermodynamically physical reaction, it reduces the potential energy of the reactions, and it cannot change the position of equilibrium of reversible reaction. And in a given catalyst will not necessarily catalyze equally all or several possible reactions. So in reaction mixture, choice of the catalyst is needed to accelerate selectively desired reaction. So in some reactions, the catalyst role is to get the selective that product. So to reduce the separation cost basically. So this is a simple graphical form of the catalysis. If you use the catalyst, you can see the energy required will be with less to transform the reactant to products. And with catalyst, it will be higher. Coming to the why catalysis. Now we understood what is a catalyst, but why this catalysis is required. If you see, there is a plant and animal fossil fuel decomposed to coal and oil. It takes up millions of years. If you keep like that in forest and anywhere, so it will not degrade easily. It will take long time to degrade and will form the different products, which is basically carbon-based. Then second is oxygen. If you see the simple example, when oxygen and air react in presence of iron to form the rust, but that is basically one type of catalytic reaction in presence of the iron, which is catalyzed and which form the rust on your iron. One good example is a photosynthesis. There the plant is making their food by sunlight, carbon dioxide and water. In terms of sunlight, which is acting as a role in natural catalysis also. So if you see inside our bodies also, almost around 64,000 red blood cells on our head of the pins. And all the cells in our body carry out a millions of chemical reaction in our body. So total number of chemical reaction in the human body is about 400 billion. Per second, every second of your life. So you can see so many reactions are happening in our body, in your mind, in your thought, and even our human body, which runs on the catalyst. So many proteins which are present in terms of the enzyme acts as a catalyst called as enzyme, which do the everything from the creating a signal that move your limbs to helping digest your food. And they are truly fundamental part of our life. Second partly hydrogen peroxide, which is formed in our body during the metabolism and which is basically harmful to our liver. So one of the catalysts which is generated in your body, which did not allow to break into the hydroxy radical, which is harmful to our proteins and DNA. So then it will be decomposed to H2 and water in small quantity and oxygen. So that reaction is very fast, within a second. So that catalysis can play a role in our body also. So ultimately, most chemical reactions are too slow, too useful. But catalyst makes chemical reactions faster. Coming to the historical development of industrial catalysis, how this catalysis has grown historically, that it is very important to know, because always we work on the history. In any areas, we go in the history, how it has happened, and then we build on that, any research also. So in 18th century, during First World War, when the industrial revolution was there, there was requirement of a lot of sulfuric acid, nitric acid for our fertilizers. So in 18th century, the first catalytic process was developed to oxidize the sulfur dioxide to SO3, which makes to alum. And when we dissolve in water, it will get the H2SO4. So that was the first process which is based on the catalyst, where the catalyst was used platinum base. That is that these are noble metals. You know, all of you know platinum, palladium, these are the noble metal. So catalyst was first coined in 1835. That was a major discovery of happened in the catalyst. Then the growth has happened throughout the years. So in 19, the nitric acid formation was there for H2SO4. Then methanol, where we are making the acetic acid and other products, it has come in 1923, followed by Fischer-Tropsch synthesis to make the olefins, malic acids, fats and oil has come. And then major discovery has come in 1937 in catalysis, that is ethyl oxide production, where we are using this polyester monoethylene glycol and other products of ethyl oxide. Then FCC has come, fluid catalytic cracking. There we are making this olefins basically, propylene, by cracking the crude oils. Then in 1950, the reforming has come to transform this benzene, toluene, xylene from crude oil. So that BTX has come in the picture. So whatever, sir, today toluene, benzene, and xylene, which are a raw material building block for various drugs, that has come in 1950. Before that also, but the major impact of that catalyst has happened by reforming process. Followed by then, Ziegler-Natta catalyst has come for polymerization, various polyethylene, polypropylene, various processes has come. Ziegler-Natta has done a lot of discovery on that. Hydrocracking, isomerization catalyst, ZSM5, the geolite-based catalyst, which has discovered by Mobil company, and which has a large applications in refinery and petrochemicals. Then propylene oxide, which has a large application in our polyurethane foams right now. What are the foams we are seeing? That is based on polypropylene oxide and polyol base. And then paraxylene has make by oxidation, this isomerization. And then followed by atoxos catalyst, that is car converter, which is coming in the catalyst. Followed by metallocene polymers, biodiesel. And now the next generation research is going on, mostly the bio-based, which is also based on the various catalysis structures and properties. If you see in 2070, the gentleman Art won the Nobel Prize for the chemistry for detailing the molecular mechanism of catalytic oxidation of carbon monoxide, which is happening on the platinum catalyst. And that was the major discovery has happened in the car industry to root out this pollution. So that has converted basically SOx and NOx. So if you see in all the cars, whatever we are using, that is basically on catalytic converter, which allows the complete combustion of low concentration of unburned hydrocarbon. And that demand is more than 200 ton of the platinum widely used worldwide year base. So that is a major discovery in the catalysis, which was catalytic converter. But apart from that, now it is widely used in petrochemical, refinery, pharmaceuticals, and specialty chemicals. Generally, catalysts are magic catalysts, basically. If you see, people are reported as a magic catalyst. Why it is magic? When I study the chemistry and catalysis, there is a lot of understanding and discoveries, mechanisms are there. But simple example, in simple way, I will just explain you. Simple, if you take ethylene and if you react with oxygen, and if you take silver as a metal as a catalyst, you will get ethylene oxide. But same, if you change the catalyst only, if you take the platinum, you will get CO2 and water. Again, if I take palladium, which is a Wacker process, Wacker oxidation process, I will get acetaldehyde. So that is the reason this catalyst is basically magic metals, all the noble metals, all catalysts. But simple, to simplify, just I am showing how this metal can play chemistry and can make a different molecule. So why this is happening basically? This is happening due to the Sabatier principle, which is well known in physical chemistry. What it says basically? It says that the interaction between your molecule and catalyst surface, it should be optimum. It should not too weak, it should not be too strong. If it is too strong, then you will get CO2. If it is too weak, your reaction will not happen. And then it should be, if you optimum, then your chemistry will play. But apart from that, there are other properties also of this metal. Is oxygen state, unfilled d orbitals, and then properties of the metal, electromagnetic properties, which are also responsible. But major is the Sabatier principle, which form a optimum bond and heat of release the heat of the adsorption when the this reactant adsorb on the catalyst surface. So this whole chemistry is based on the Sabatier principle, which is due to the chemiabsorption strength of your reacting molecule and catalyst surface. One more thing for this noble metals, basically palladium, palladium, rhodium. That is basically, apart from that, the temperature, high temperature. These metals are basically melting point is very high, more than 1000 degree. So for that, the thermodynamic temperature basically is considered. The temperature at which the mobility and reactivity of molecule become appreciable. So that metals are stable at that temperature, which are sustainable to moisture, sulfur, any impurities are there. And if you see palladium, platinum, rhodium, silver, and gold, I have mentioned here. So out of that, platinum, palladium, and rhodium, which has the highest melting point and thermodynamic temperature, basically. So why it is important? I already mentioned it has high melting point and variable oxygen state. Why it is important? Basically, if you see the catalytic converter is made up of the three metal, platinum, palladium, and rhodium, because the catalytic exhaust temperature is around 600 to 700 degrees in temperature. If I use gold or silver, that metal will melt at that temperature. So I can't use that metal. So if you see the current catalytic converter, in that you will see all the three metals. And earlier it was only two-way catalyst, platinum and palladium. Now rhodium they have put to convert the NOx, because the platinum and palladium was not susceptible to convert this NOx into N2. So in all the modern car, we are seeing this catalytic converter. Coming to the industrial segments where this catalyst is basically used, that I mentioned already, petrochemicals, polymers, environmentals, so it is a major role, or refining for different processes, and then biofuels, biochemicals, biopolymers. If you see the overall industry, it is around 85 to 90% product of chemical industries are made by catalytic process. And if you see worldwide for transportation fuel, around 700 oil refineries are all over the world. Production of bulk and chemical in all the branches of chemical industries. And prevention of pollution by avoiding the formation of waste generated byproduct. Abatement of pollution in end pipe solution that we can achieve by the environmental catalysis. The catalyst offer in an alternatively energetically favorable mechanism over the non-catalytic reaction, basically. What is the driving force to work in the catalysis and what is the demand for that? So if you see from 2017 to 2023, the demand is growing in refining, petrochemicals, polymers, fine chemicals, and environmental. So the business is around more than 31 billions. And now as it is growing, so people are trying to utilize syngas, derivatives, and mostly the oxidation or selective oxidation. And environmental also, it is growing due to the emissions limits and the environmental regulations from the government. So this is overall the global catalyst market business for the various processes. Coming to the catalytic material, what are the materials generally used as a catalyst? So in catalysis also, there are two types of catalysis. One is homogeneous catalysis, one is heterogeneous catalysis. So homogeneous catalysis, those catalysts which are used in PPM level, very low quantity, and which are soluble in the products. Sometimes it is recoverable also. Sometimes people are recovering by different methods. But today I will give much focus on the heterogeneous catalysis because due to time limitations. So if you see heterogeneous catalysis, these are a solid acid catalysis which can be reused, recycled, and which is used in a fixed bed reactor, continuous processes. And this type of material basically, like alumina, which is expensive material, very available in India, which has high surface area, which is required for heterogeneous catalysis to happen, the reaction on the surface and pores, which is also one of the material is used as a catalyst. Silica also used as a catalyst support also, metal support. If you put platinum, palladium, then supported metal catalyst can be prepared. One class is geolite, that is aluminum silicates, which has a controlled pore size. There the shape selectivity is required. If you want to prepare one molecule, which is basically shape selective, like ortho-metaparaxylene. So based on the molecule size, only the paraxylene molecule will pass through the pores. And then it can be modified acidic and alkaline. If you want to make acidity, if you require acidity for the reactions, then you can make acidity. And alkaline also, base catalyzed reaction also, you can do as alkaline, under alkaline media. Basically, all these material are distributed in the three parts, which has a porosity basically. Micropores less than 2 nanometers, mesopores 50 nanometers, and macropores, they're big pores. These pores are basically required to distribution of the metals and then the diffusion of your product molecule or reactant molecule. So the catalyst looks like that. This is a porous solid. These are the pores. So your molecule will enter inside the pore. It will interact on the surface of the catalyst. It will form various intermediates, and then again it will dissolve from the catalyst surface. So that is a mechanism generally happen. Apart from that, there are various supports. Activated carbon also large quantity people are using in the industry. Then zirconia, titania, magnesia. These also are explored for the catalyst support. If you see the industrial catalyst design, as I am industry person, so just I will explain how the industrial catalyst has been designed in the industry for any process and what are the criteria basically to make this catalyst. So if you want to develop any catalyst, new catalyst, or you want to improve the existing catalyst, so you should be aware of all this knowledge basically. You should know the catalyst preparation methods, which are the catalyst preparation methods which is suitable for your catalyst. Then you have to perform the activity. It should perform in your transformation. If you are doing oxidation, hydrogenation, then you have to check that. Then mechanical properties, because these are the industrial catalyst, so it will be in different form shapes. It will not in the powder form. So you have to consider the mechanical properties, bulk density, which goes in the reactor, which should sustain high pressure and temperature. And then the chemistry, basically, surface acidity, composition of the catalyst, surface area, what is the surface area of my catalyst, chemical and physical properties, total composition. Because the catalyst looks like this in the industry. If you see, these are the all industrial catalyst and different forms. You can see extruded, tablet form, cylindrical form. There's a hollow cylindrical. This is a monolith type of things, which is basically used in car converter. And these shapes also are very important because depend on the shape, the application is there. Due to in high pressure, reduce the heat of the reactions, exothermicity should be encountered. Then the shapes are useful. So if you want to develop industrial catalyst, then you have to aware of all these shapes also. And then chemistry, how I can make the catalyst, which is can sustain long life in the catalyst, which will not deactivate easily, which will give the desired product. So basically, catalyst design is an optimum combination of interdependent, all mechanical, chemical, physical properties. It takes a lot of efforts. Some catalysts require 5 years, 3 years, 10 years to develop the catalyst, because the catalyst should work on commercial scale. That is the criteria. In the lab, it may work. If I prepare 10 gram catalyst, it may work. But if I want to scale up 100 tons or 1 tons, then that property should match. So if you see just a brief, what are the preparation methods generally used in the heterogeneous catalysis? So these are the precursor basically. Catalyst preparation impregnation is a crucial step in the preparation of industrial catalyst. So precursor like noble metal, I am taking chloroplatic acid, palladium chloride. Then I have to mix on the porous oxide support. I have to mix properly, impregnate properly. This is a very crucial step because the platinum or palladium should be uniformly distributed on my alumina or silica support, which should give the proper size also. And then I have to dry properly to remove the solvent or water. And then followed by thermal treatment, I have to calcine all the organic material which is used in the catalyst preparation to control the size of platinum shape. And finally, I have to reduce the metal basically, all the platinum, palladium, which are active in zero oxygen state. So if it is an oxygen state, it will be plus N, plus 2, N, plus 4. So that hydrogen reduction method also is there. Apart from that, there is a precipitation equilibrium method also is there for basically geolite type of material synthesis, which is used by precipitation technique, sol gel technique. And then some catalysts are prepared by drying, mixing, just mixing and grinding. But on commercial scale, the game is different. There, our human involvement will be not there. So you have to develop the mechanism or instrument. There, the whole impregnation can be done. So here one example I am giving. This alumina support is there or silica support. So I am spraying my impregnating solution uniformly. And then I am taking the batches, 50 kg, 100 kg like that. So and then I have to match with the laboratory performance. That is a major challenge. That is we are facing the challenge basically in the industry, scale up and manufacturing. And now the one more technique, the atomic layer deposition. If you need thin layer of the coating, like single crystal catalyst, there the concept is coming and many people are working on these approaches. But that is also really challenging to scale up that process. Now coming to the characterization. So this gentleman's all the people has a lot of contribution. What today we are seeing the characterization or chemical properties due to this contribution of these people, which has started from Sir Isaac Newton in 1640, which has developed the concept of spectrum, which is a rainbow of the colors. After that, Joseph has discovered that the dark absorption line, which are available in the spectrum. Then Albert Einstein has took the advantage of that. He has developed the photoelectric effect, which is right now, whatever the chemistry we are doing, we are measuring the oxygen state, XPS, which is based on the photoelectric effect. That Kai Sebin has discovered the XPS spectroscopy, and then all the characterization we are doing by that technique now. Apart from that, Dr. Isaac has done a lot of work in acid-base titration. Today, whatever the titration, acid-base potentiometric, that is his discovery. He has put a lot of effort, a lot of papers are available if you see him. So that has a great contribution from Dr. Isaac. Now, apart from that, our own Dr. C.V. Raman, who has developed the Raman effect, which is widely used in the chemical industries to understand the properties of different metal. Recently, we have celebrated the National Science Day on this occasion. And our own Dr. Satyendranath Bose, who has also a lot of contribution in quantum mechanism to understand all this spectroscopic technique. How this technique is helpful for the catalyst characterization, basically. If you see, if I want to characterize my catalyst by textual, physical, and chemical properties, so I'm taking the advantage of all the electromagnetic spectrum, X-rays, IR, electron, magnetic, UV light. If I use X-ray, I'm getting the different phase of the material, different phase of the catalyst. If I'm using IR, that is used in organic functional group, catalyst also functionality, we can understand by IR. Electron spectroscopy by electron gun, TM, SEM, we can see the morphology and microstructure of the your different catalyst. And with the help of NMR, we can see the acidity, phase composition. So all these techniques are very important. Without this characterization, it is difficult to develop the catalyst, because we should know the correlation of the performance, how my catalyst is performing. Then basically it is a determination of its physical and chemical characteristics, which are responsible for performance in the reactions. And now people are coming to operator spectroscopy, that is in situ characterization, where all the technique, major technique, you have to merge together. And your catalyst, you have to study under the reaction. When the reaction is happening, then you have to understand your catalyst, how it is performing, and then you have to use different technique for that catalyst. Now coming to the RIL major products, because we are working in the energy company, RIL is a major energy sector. So just I will talk few things on the our company. If you see, Reliance is making various products, but apart from that, we are making the liquid LPG for domestic industrial fuel. Propylene we are making, feedstock for propylene, naphtha for feedstock for propylene, petrochemicals. We are making gasoline, largest gasoline, around 9,000 ton. We are making the fuel, transport fuel, then jet fuel, high speed diesel. And we are getting a lot of sulfur basically as a byproduct of the crude oil, around more than 1 million metric ton. So that sulfur is going for feedstock for sulfur fertilizer, a different fertilizer we are making sulfur based, Reliance also is making. And then pharmaceutical drugs also sulfur is highly used. And we are generating large quantity of petroleum coke. That coke basically used for our fuel as a power plant and cement plant. Now again, we have come up with the coke gasification. There we are trying to make the olefins. Already it has started, petroleum coke to ethylene and propylene. So this is our biggest refinery in Jamnagar, where we are processing more than 1.35 million barrel per capacity of the crude oil. And we are making different products. The few products I am just showing, Ripol, this is polypropylene, Relfix elastomer base, Relude, we have make the composite material which looks like property wise it is matching with the wood. Rayon, this is a basic polyvinyl chloride, what is the PVC pipe we are seeing, that is the raw material Reliance is making. Relab, this is basically linear alkyl benzene, so which is used for all the surface detergent, surfactant detergent, whatever the soap we are seeing, Rin or Surf Excel, so raw material Reliance is making. And again, Reliance aviation fuel, that is also from these different processes we are making. So if you see, Reliance is the largest producer of petrochemicals in the country and among top 10 in the world. And if you estimate all this product, what I'm showing, 90% product showed above. The catalyst is involved in some stage in their manufacturing. So role of the catalyst is very important in producing all the chemicals. And in brief, if you see the slide, it is not very clear, but this is our integration of our company. So you know, a lot of efforts are there to make these chemicals, a lot of chemistry is involved. Every stage chemistry is involved if you see catalyst is involved. So Reliance has started from exploration. They have done the backward integration, but just I'm showing for exploration. So we have the exploration in KG Basin, there we are extracting the gas. And second option, we are making the crude oil. That is, we are processing the crude oil. From natural gas, we are making ethane and propane. We are cracking that. And as a LPG, we are using. But from crude oil, we are making LPG, gasoline, ATF, that I have shown sulfur, propane, coke. But apart from that, we are making the different petrochemicals. At every stage, the catalyst is required. Acrylonitrile, that is the carbon fiber, which is a raw material for carbon fiber in defense. That also Reliance on making PVC pipe, that also by chlorination process, then HDP, LDP, then butadiene, benzene, ethyl oxide, which is a silver base. Again, MEG, this is also now catalyst based. PBR, different rubber we are making by different catalytic process, polymerization. And then major is the purified PTA, that also we are making more than 5 million ton by paraxylene oxidation. That is a raw material for PET, polyester chips, filament, iron. So every process, it will take long time to explain. And everywhere the role of the catalyst and process is very important. But important part is the chloralkali plant also we have, which is based on electrolysis process. There people are talking, but it's a commercial plant. We are making the chlorine, and there we are using for the chlorination to make the VCM. This is whole integration of the basically polymers, polyester, petrochemicals, refinery extrusion. So basically it is helping to build meet our energy demands. Now, one of the examples, just I will show you, I will not go all the details. This is one of the product we are making, which is based on the polymerization. Vinyl chloride is an organochloride with the formula of H2SCl, H2CSCl. This is the raw material for the PVC pipe, basically. So this has replaced all the copper or duct ion, if you see in the India and worldwide. So we are producing at three sites this polyvinyl chloride. Simple process, looks very simple. Ethylene we are taking the HCl and oxygen, oxidative donation we are doing. And EDC is a product. In EDC, we are cracking at high temperature, and then we are getting the vinyl chloride monomer. So this is a process, basically ethylene HCl, and there the copper-based catalyst is used. And the process conditions are like ethylene is high pressure, 5 bar temperature, 300 degrees centigrade. And the copper catalyst, I have shown copper and alumina. The shape I have shown. So one of the shape is the cylindrical shape. There, the copper supported on alumina. And then after the spent catalyst, it is very important to understand the catalyst properties. The catalyst life is around 1.5 to 2 years. But still, lot of scope is there to improve this catalyst. So if somebody come up with the better catalyst, then the economies can change the process. And even we can reduce the energy cost economies of the process. So the reaction is highly exothermic, and due to low relative cost of ethylene, most of the vinyl chloride has been produced by this technique after 1950. And this is a raw material for various products, basically you can see in the picture. One more product, purified terephthalic acid, that we are making in large quantity, more than 5 million metric ton at various sites. And that is a raw material for polyester PET production. So this is made by paraxylene oxidation. Again, these are the side product. These are various side product which has been formed in the paraxylene oxidation, and target is terephthalic acid. But during the process, this 4-carboxybenzaldehyde impurity form, which is around 5000 ppm. So that is very important to convert this into tolic acid, which is water soluble. Otherwise, it will impact on the quality of terephthalic acid. It will not completely white, it will be yellowish. So for that, palladium on carbon catalyst basically used to convert out that. So role of the catalyst is very important. Here, if you don't convert, then there is no demand for this product. So here, palladium on carbon has catalyst has been developed, and our Reliance also has developed the catalyst for this process. Now coming to the health security, some part I have covered about energy. Now I will talk few minutes on health security. So if you see in health, basically the role of the catalyst is basically to make the different drugs. And the major drugs, if you see naproxen, ibuprofen, and various drug intermediate that are formed by the catalysis. And if you see the importance of the catalysis in asymmetric synthesis or chiral catalysis, that is a special enantiomer. So if you see, today more than half of the drugs existing today are chiral compound. And the fastest growing chiral end use is anti-sepsin, cancer therapies, antivirals, antibiotics, and anti-diabetics drugs. And the market, if you see, the global market, chiral market size is estimated to $60 billion in 2019. And this is predicted to reach around $150 billion by 2030. So the role of the catalyst is basically in chiral catalyst is very important. If you see all the in pharmaceutical industries, around 56% drugs are chiral drugs, which is R or S, that is only active for the your drugs, and other is unreactive. And then in therapeutic use also, 88% are based on the enantiomers basically. And if you see, there are the major drugs which has been based on the catalyst base basically, which is racemic and heterogeneous catalyst or homogeneous catalyst, so chiral catalyst. One of these is Monsanto has developed the L-DOPA process, which is widely used to synthesis these drugs. Apart from that, this anamine hydrogenation, stipaglin, anti-diabetic drugs also has been developed by this enzyme catalysis. And this pregabalin also biocatalyst lipase, which was used for resolution of cyanodiester for to treat the clinical depression. There also these drugs has been widely used. And the role of the catalyst in the process is very important. And this paroxactamine also has been produced by Glaxo. This is a green process they have developed recently, which is used for NXCT and disorders and critical step for enzyme catalysis. So if you see overall in this health security also, in large quantity, this catalyst have been used. Now, if you see the impact of this chiral catalysis in 2001, these three gentlemen, Dr. Willem, Dr. Noyeri, and very sharpless, Professor Jerepe, they got a Nobel Prize for their discovery for this chiral catalysis. Now coming to the third part of my talk is this environmental part. Can you somebody mute the speaker? Thank you. So if you all of know, the Paris Agreement on climate change has happened in 2015 in the Paris, and that was basically to see the impact of this global warming and the CO2 emission or environment. So basically the agreement present the action plan, which should be well below less than 2 degrees centigrade. It covers the period from 2020. So they have made some plan in 2015 and all the countries was involved in that. So what was that plan basically? The basic plan was to mitigate this emissions. And long term was to increase the global average temperature to well below industrial level. Again, to limit the increase 1.5 degrees centigrade, that was the target, and reduce the risk and impact of the climate change. On the need of global emissions, recognize it will take longer time for developing countries. So that action plan is made, and they have categorized the different countries. And to undertake the rapid reduction, best available science, how we can use to deal with the all these pollutions. If you see in France right now, currently they are generating 90% electricity from zero carbon sources, including nuclear, hydroelectric and wind. But for other countries, they are in the growing stage. So slowly they are adopting and they are developing their own technology. But if you see in this Paris Agreement, almost more than 195 nations were involved. So where we stand, India on track. India also was actively involved in this Paris Agreement. So under this Paris Agreement, India has committed to reduce the emissions and power capacity based on non-fossil fuel source by 2030. So that India has commitment, we will reduce this non-fossil, we'll use the mostly non-fossil source by 2020 and we'll work on the alternative sources. So where we stand now, reduce the emissions intensity by 33 to 35%. That was a target from 2005. So if you see in 2005, it was 1.41, and now historically that was their objective. And this current formal pledge, the report has been recently published from Government of India. So now in the last 4 years, there are many clean and green initiatives government is taking at national level, state level, which is significantly contributing to adopt the and mitigation on climate change. So that is contributing and change we are seeing. So, but it is a long way we have to go because economically also it is set to be met. But now government is coming in the solar panels, electrical vehicles. So that initiative already has, they have started. But major thing is the electric, major 40% electric power install capacity that they want to reduce. Right now, if you see 75%, we are using as a non-fossil fuel, which is basically oil-based that we are importing. 25%, it is alternative sources. But now the target is to go with around 40% with that non-fossil fossil fuel and 60% fossil. So that is our Indian government target in 2030. So the ambitious goal basically generating 175 gigawatt of renewable energy by 2022 by smart cities, electrical vehicles that I already talked. And this fourth BV4 to BV6 stage emission norms to minimize the impact on climate change. So why we are talking about the environment, where these VOCs and emissions are coming basically. So if you see our energy demand, total energy supply in India, total energy supply is around more than 800 million ton of the oil, which is required to meet our Indian demand. Out of that, 44% is coming from the coal, oil 25%, bioenergy, and waste basically 21%, natural gas 5.8%, hydro and nuclear are very light, wind also 0.4 and 0.6%. The major consumption in industrial sector 42% total final consumption, followed by residential 29%, transport, residential services that is coming. And as per the projection basically, the demand will go double in 2040. Then electricity demand also will triple in next 20 years. So with rise in the energy demands and major impact will be on definitely on environment. So if you go with different renewable sources, but it is very difficult to immediately convert all the sources to get these renewable energies. So what will happen? It will impact on your air pollution. So if you see the current level of the air pollution, the increasing air pollution in several cities, Gurgaon, Delhi, Faridabad, this is a key concern. And basically energy sector has been identified as a major source of CO2 emission, NOx emissions, and this is particulate emissions. So if you read this report published by government, what they are saying, around 20 most polluted cities in the world and 10 are from the India. And this situation is really alarming in 2017, which has caused around 1.2 million premature death. Now government also has been also revised this emissions norms. If you see CO2 and NOx, that is now 100 milligram per meter cube. And this particulate is should be less than 30 milligram per meter cube. So that is government also is taking a lot of initiatives on the policies, and they are targeting to affordable solution, which is can reduce the emissions and which can help our economic growth. Globally emissions, if you see the current scenario in 2019, so I have given the example, top three emitters, so definitely China, then Europe, USA, but they are targeting the carbon neutral by 2050. That is their objective. Further on, India. So India, if you see around, it is 8%. So India contributes total 7% of total global emissions, transport contribution, and total 10% of total emission in India. So here we are. So we can see China now, pressure, lot of pressure on China in terms of emissions, because lot of production capacity they are enhancing 10 times compared to India. So we are lacking in the manufacturing capability in terms of auto sector, pharma sector, specialty sector. Then now in US also, Joe Biden expressed to make the America carbon neutral by 2050. In Europe also want to become carbon neutral by 2050. So plan to reduce the CAG emission to 50 to 60% by 2030. So all the seriousness is there towards the global CO2 emissions, and that action plan also people are working. Now coming to the major part is the VOC, where the VOCs are releasing and where, what are the solution for that? So if you see the term volatile organic compound, basically it comes from boiling compounds of the all the organic compound below 250 degree at atmosphere pressure. And this is a large class of the compound, basically all ketones, aldehyde, aromatics, paraffins, and these are basically harmful. If you see, it depletes the ozone depletion, ground level smoke formation on the plant, climate change, basically sick building door syndrome. If you stay in big cities like Mumbai or Delhi, you can feel that always you will be cold and cup during the years due to these pollutions, toxicity in the atmosphere, and major the carcinogenic impact in the humans. And where these VOCs basically are coming, it is from all the industries: chemical, petroleum refineries, pharmaceuticals, automobile, food, textile, electronic component. And emission wise contribution also we can see is industrial process, product use, energy productions, road transport. So there are more than 1,000 VOCs are reported, which is impacting on our health and atmosphere and environment. So this is basically what WHO says. WHO says is 7 million people currently die prematurely every year this far, surpassed by death by rising the temperature and extreme weather if the emission continue to rise at the present rate. So most of the common VOCs are formaldehyde, which are generating in various processes, causing the cancer in animal, human, which is used to building our materials, household products. Then benzene, toluene, phenol, propane, styrene, these are also major family of pollutants, which is emissions from industrial automotive emissions. Then toluene and propane also are specially, basically propane are photochemical ozone creativity potentials are reported. And chlorinated, that is also very harmful. Dichloromethane, chloroform, carbon tetrachloride has widespread applications. And then if you see, the countries has imposed a strict condition to hemosis. The numerous research initiatives around the world developing efficient technology to meet the stringent environmental regulation. And these are the basically compound which are mostly carcinogenic VOCs, mostly carbon tetrachloride, benzyl chloride, aniline, urethane. So these are out of that highly carcinogenic compound, along with benzene also is highly carcinogenic. What are the methods basically used for VOC abatement? There are various methods industries are adopting. So there are two types of method basically. One is a destruction, one is a recovery, which is emitting from the industries, different areas. Then in destruction, oxidation is one of the method which is used, thermal oxidation. You can incinerate all the VOCs at very high temperature, 900 to 900 degree temperature. Second way is a catalytic oxidation. There, if you use the catalyst, then you can reduce the temperature by 40%, you can reduce the energy. And the reverse flow reactor also, one type of catalytic reactor. Biofiltration also, you can use the microbes here, which can convert this VOC into CO2 and water. Apart from that, there are other method, recovery methods also. Absorption, you can use the different solvents, cyclohexyl amine based solvent. You can absorb this VOC and then you can distill out. Adsorption also, you can use in adsorption technology, zeolite or activated carbon. You can adsorb and then you can dissolve the activity based on the concentration. If the concentration is more, then this type of technology is used. Again, condensation, these VOCs are at low boiling point, 250, then you can condense that and you can recover. There are membrane also, silicon based or polymer membrane also are being widely used, which are expensive right now. That also based on the permeability, which is used for these VOC separations. Out of that, the catalytic oxidation incineration is widely used to deal with this VOC, which is going into the atmosphere, which limit is less than 220 ppm. So it is a more viable option because your catalyst will convert all this VOC into CO2 and water, and operating temperature is less than 350 degree temperature compared to the thermal oxidation, which is 1000 degree centigrade. But one of the major challenges catalyst oxidation is a catalyst development, because different types of VOCs are there. So you should have a lot of understanding of this catalyst. And then based on the catalytic property, one can design the catalyst really with this VOCs. These are the catalytic material basically used for VOC removal: noble metal, metal oxide base, and mostly the formulations that I mentioned based on the VOCs. And apart from the noble metal, platinum and palladium, in spite of their cost, this is preferred due to their higher activities. And then in recent years, people are developing this magnesium, copper base also, mixed metal oxide pair catalyst also. That is also replacement for noble metal. Then again, monolith, where the fluorides and pressures are issued, then this monolith type of structure has been used. That is also ceramic structure. And then this even metallic chromium steel type of structure also can be explored for this ceramic monolith or VOC combustion. But globally, if you see noble metal catalyst as due to higher selectivity towards CO2, when the VOC combust, it will not restrict to only CO. The CO2 to CO2 will convert by noble metal. So that is the reason compared to metal oxide, this CO, this noble metal catalyst are widely explored. Now I will talk on something we develop in the Reliance as R&D few catalyst. So this is one of the catalyst we have developed in the Reliance, basically is for nitrogen purification. So in-house we have developed from lab to commercial scale, and we have completely replaced our catalyst under Make in India initiative. So the process is very simple. Here what we are doing, we are doing solid state polymerization. Basically we are taking paraxylene, this terephthalic acid which is made from paraxylene, then we are reacting with ethylene glycol and we are making polyethylene terephthalate, okay, PET synthesis. Then that PET synthesis is going for solid state polymerization, because there are two type of polymerization, is a continuous polymerization, solid state polymerization. In solid state polymerization, for different type of PET resins we are making, this type of PET pastel which goes in high quality resin material. So for that, basically it is used to make this material. In this process, large quantity of nitrogen gas is used, which is very expensive. More than 10,000 meter cube nitrogen is used. Then we have to recycle that nitrogen. If you don't recycle that nitrogen, then the quality of this PET pastel will be yellowish color. So to convert that organic impurities, which is present nitrogen gas, which is coming from the solid state polymerization, basically acetaldehyde, ethylene glycol, that should be converted to CO2 and water, and then you can recycle. So reaction is hydrocarbon plus oxygen and then CO2 and water. So R&D has developed this catalyst which has low temperature, high GSVC. This is basically platinum supported on alumina catalyst, which has higher catalyst life. And after the spent catalyst, the platinum is recoverable. We can recover the catalyst after spent catalyst. And that catalyst is we have efficiently used in our plant, and we have replaced the imported catalyst. And this catalyst basically has showed more than 20% higher performance than competitor catalyst. That also we have observed. This is one of the catalysts, the Reliance oxidation catalyst. And if you see the performance wise, this is a commercial catalyst, this is our lab catalyst, and this is a commercial catalyst performance we got. And this catalyst has developed less than a year, you know, developed. And now this catalyst we have manufactured during the COVID. This manufacturing, one of the plant we have started in the month of July 2020, and whole in the COVID, during COVID, we went there, and in our presence, we have developed this catalyst. So this is basically platinum supported on alumina catalyst. You can see that these are the platinum particle, nanoparticle. This is nano catalyst. The particle size is around 5 to 10 nanometer. So that is the critical step in the catalyst. We have to control this size. If you don't get the size, then you will not get the performance. And this catalyst looks like that. For the student, maybe those they are not aware of the catalyst. The catalyst is spherical and blackish color. The blackish color is due to the platinum is in reduced state after the oxidation. Oxidation state may be the white color or slightly grayish, but after reduction it is completely black. So this is one of the batch, right? Recently we have dispatched to our Hajira site successfully, and now we are trying to license this technology to outside also. One more technology we have developed for oxidation of benzene. Benzene is highly carcinogenic basically. So all of you know, if you deal with benzene, so then companies also are very stringent to handle with that. And benzene is used in many chemical petrochemical plant, and in Reliance we are also making benzene. But what is happening during the loading in the tanker, some of the benzene, this is the tanker loading. So when you load the benzene in the tanker, we use the service air to decrease the vapor pressure of benzene. But along with the vent air, some of the 200 ppm benzene will come out with that air. So that will harmful to the people working in that area. So then we have developed the process to deal with this benzene. We have put our catalytic oxidation reactor after the vent. That is converting more than 99% benzene into CO2 and water. And that also pilot scale we have developed this process. And now we are extending this VOC areas. This is one area we are working. Basically, this is a mechanism is happening on the catalyst surface. Your VOC molecule, the benzene molecule, which is reacting with the lattice oxygen of your metal, platinum or palladium. And that metal is reducing. Again, the oxygen, which is present in the air, which is one of the reactant, which is oxidizing the platinum. Then basically it is a redox mechanism. Oxidation reduction is happening on the surface, and the catalyst is again regenerating. So the mechanism based on the Mars 1 Kraepelin mechanism to completely decompose the CO2 and water. And this is a highly exothermic reaction. Around 3000 kilojoule per mole of the energy will be released during the reaction. Then we have developed other processes also, other VOCs also, ethylene and methane, which are the impurities forming in CO2 purification at one of our MEG plant. There also we have developed the catalyst. These are different catalysts, not the same catalyst we have shown, because every same catalyst will not work out for all the VOCs. And some of the catalysts we have on the lab scale developed for the gasoline VOC emissions during the tanker loading, or you know, petrol pump. When you go to on any petrol pump, there must be emissions of this petrol diesel. So there also we are trying to develop some scheme where the small reactor can be used to convert this VOC in water. But that is really challenging because you have to reduce the temperature. So that is a real challenge for the researcher. Now coming to some innovations we have done at R&D. At Reliance, we are working on various innovations, and this is only possible due to the continuous research and involvement of the scientists. So one product we have developed is a fluorinated CPVC. Basically, this is a visible blue LED-based photoreactor design we have designed. This is in the world first time we have developed this type of polymer. This is based on the chlorination of PVC. PVC is one, but chlorination, you are doing chlorination under visible light. So then property will change and you will get a very high quality PVC material. So that process already we have developed and it is on commercial stage. And we have developed one catalyst that is a para-diethyl benzene alkylation. Ethyl benzene plus ethanol or ethylene. There also we have developed geolate-based catalyst that I talk shape-selective catalyst. There we will get shape-selective diethyl benzene like para-xylene. So that is the own catalyst we have developed. This is own process in Reliance. It is in Hajira. So we are making a lot of para-diethyl benzene. That is the raw material for divinyl benzene. Apart from that, a lot of work recently has done in algae to oil, because as an alternative part of the energy, so our R&D is working on algae basically. Algae powders we have make in a very big area in Jamnagar. And apart from that, the other resources also, lignin, that we are looking, this waste from agriculture waste, basically breaking, and method is hydrocatalytic cracking. There also we are using different catalysts. So that process also we have developed on pilot scale, and it is also under licensing stage Reliance is using to make this oil and to blend with our petrol and diesel basically. Then Reliance has made the new polymer basically, composite material, which is a bullet jacket proof jacket. There also basically special grade of polyethylene, which is the catalyst is very specific in that. Reliance has developed our R&D has developed our own catalyst, and this jacket has been tested in defense. You can see the bullet also here that has been tested. The bullet is inside the jacket. So that whole discovery and more than 100 patents we have filed on this discovery. All the discovery what we are showing here. Then recent development is the halogenation of sulfur. Basically, I told you more than 1 million ton of the sulfur we are generating. So now we are working with various agriculture universities in India. Lot of work has been done in Punjab, Delhi, Maharashtra. So what we have developed here, the sulfur basically we are making some composite, and this sulfur is used in soda soil where the soda is more. So when you put this sulfur, so it will make sodium sulfate and it will neutralize your soil. So these are the commercial trial in field trial has taken different crops. Different crops has been taken, and he has seen the improvement when you use the sulfur. This is the improvement in the yield. If the plant is being 5 kilo, so with that almost 25-30-40% the improvement we have seen with the help of sulfur. So that technology also is ready, and now discussion is with the government to launch this product under Relfarm brand name. Again, in the road development also the sulfur we have mixed with bitumen. So there also the composite we have make, and the trial has been taken, and almost a 30-kilometer road has been made in Jamnagar, and now it is under testing. So once it is proven, so we already with the Natural Highway Authority, this has been discussion has held, and a lot of data has been generated as per their requirement, so that sulfur can be one of the alternative can be used recycle for this road applications. Apart from that, we have done a lot of work for ETP, wastewater treatment. That is a major impact of any industry. So waste water generated in a very highly expensive this process. So you can see the nature of the ETP water, how dirty is that. So there also we have developed the microbial culture development, and which can convert the wastewater. Again, you can recycle that water. And a lot of money and process environmental regulations are there. So these are the few things I am showing here from our group. There are many things, but due to times I can't share all these things. And we got many awards from many scientific community, national award, international award. So all the Golden Peacock Award recently got. So 10 next technology award got in last 2 years based on our technology development. All are mostly commercial based, pilot scale based, and some of the technologies which are working in the plant. Now, concept to commercialization, I talk, but how it is difficult. It is not so easy because a lot of things, a major teamwork and passion is required. So this is basically the integration, basically. When you want to develop any catalyst or any process, it has to be start from idea. how it will be new, my new product, what are the properties, then primary synthesis, screening, characterization, mechanism, kinetics in terms of catalyst, then you have to make different shapes, powder, stability test, scale up, pilot testing, reactor design, plant testing. So everything you have to go. So a lot of teams and involvement is required, various functional team, catalysis, chemistry, physical chemistry, analytical chemist, to make the catalyst or process happen on the commercial scale. So this is just integration of the various processes are involved in catalyst commercialization that we are following when you develop any catalyst that I have shown the example. Now, if you develop any catalyst, there are certain life. All the catalysts will not work for the lifelong. Some catalyst will work for 1 year, 6 months, or some catalyst maybe only 3 months due to catalyst deactivation. Because all the catalysts are metal supported, non-metal supported, but this catalyst will deactivate by the coke formation in the process at high temperature or pressure or oxidation. Some of the intermediate will form which block your pores and metal, and then it will not available for the reaction. So for certain period, it can be restored by the increase in temperature. It may possible regeneration, but for not all the reactions. Then poisonous, if there are sulfur, arsenic, lead, this also poison your catalyst. So that is also very important to control your deactivation. High temperature, if you are operating your catalyst at high temperature, then there's a migration of the particle will happen. It will sintering. So if the particle size growth is there, then activity will go down. Because we want, if we want the catalyst in nano form, that we have seen, we have understood this catalyst also. When the spent catalyst we took out from the reactor, the size may be 100 nanometer from 10 nanometer, then that catalyst will not work out. Then basically deactivation of catalyst is one of the instigated problem in industrial catalysis. It will make impact on negative impact on both on economic and environment, because spent catalyst will be generated. Again, it has to go on process. Then again, VOC generation will be there. So that also is very important if you develop a catalyst which can long last, not only the environment, but cost also. If this catalyst are very expensive, we are spending millions of dollars on the catalyst. So if we change, make 1% improvement in the catalyst, we can save crores in the process. So catalyst development is very critical for all the process. Coming to the future perspective, this is the last paraport, maybe the last 10 minutes I will take. And what are the future perspective for sustainability, for chemistry sustainability, this is a topic. Now we talk about challenges, but there are future challenges also for researcher, for chemist, catalysis, biochemist, all the researchers who are working in this area. There are many challenges which can we have to still need to be break. So one of the challenges is the selective oxidation of the hydrocarbon. That is very important industrial process. And that use catalyst in all the processes, which is based on transition metal, noble metal. So I am showing here a bulk chemical. Without that, we can't make anything like sulfuric acid, which is required in our daily process. Still, it is made by handium-based catalyst process, which is based on for fertilizer production. Still, there are many challenges and energy process challenges in sulfuric acid production. So people can look on that and we can further develop the process. Nitric acid we are making by Ostwald process, platinum-based catalyst. Formaldehyde, methanol to formaldehyde, whatever the food grade formaldehyde we are seeing by Formox process. That also based on iron and molybdenum oxide, high pressure, high temperature. There is a lot of scope is there to improve the process. Acetaldehyde we are making for Wacker process. There also palladium and copper-based catalyst are used. Ethylene oxide, that I have not covered due to time, which is silver-based. That is a magic chemistry, really. It is really magic. In last 100 years, the same catalyst has been used silver-based, and still there is no replacement for this catalyst. And we are producing more than 25 million tons of the ethylene oxide yearly by only this catalyst. And then malic anhydride, we are doing for butane oxidation. There also vanadium-based catalyst is used. Ethylene dichloride, already I touch up on that. Acrylonitrile, already CFO process there based on bismuth oxide, molybdenum oxide process. Still, same process is used. Tertiary acid, we are using by manganese and cobalt. So a lot of waste generation, manganese, cobalt. So still, a lot of improvement is expected in this process if you come up with green process to reduce the waste generation. The vinyl acetate also is a useful product in perfume industries, which is based on palladium-based catalyst. Atomizer catalyst, palladium, rhodium, environmental, and VOC removal also that I talked already. So all the processes still required a lot of challenges and scope is there to improve. So that is one area, oxidation. If you globally see for this oxidation, almost 483,000 tons of the catalyst manufactured in 2017. And now the major largest sector is growing syngas. We are a lot of syngas in India now. In Reliance also, they are trying to convert the syngas to methanol, dimethyl ether, which is a raw material for the cracker. Then selective. Now, we come to the sulfur economy business. As you know, as a 2030 roadmap. So now people are talking about linear to circular economy. So what do we right now we are doing, and now we are following up also some part already we have worked on reuse economy. So this is a chemistry we are making the product by linear economy. in that product pollution, we are generating a lot of products, side product, disposal waste, and then old linear concept based on the raw material into product. We are not bothering what is generating. We are trying to convert, but the process was like that. There's a linear economy. A plus B plus C, and along with side products. Then if you see the chemistry of reuse, basically, what we are targeting, chemistry reuse, process system, continuously use and production minimize the waste. This is a target for 2030. Basically, recycle. Whatever we make, convert, use, enjoy, reuse, remake, reconvert. So if I take reactant A plus B, if I make C, again, I can efficiently use that C, and I can again make A. So that chemistry people are talking. And in that circular economy, catalysis is a central element to enable the circular concept of keeping the molecule in play. So catalysis is a major play to work on the circular economy. What we are doing at Reliance, Reliance is the one of the largest recycler of PET bottles, PET waste in India. So currently we have the capacity of 2 billion such bottle we are recycling. We are making the raw material, and we are making the bottles again, raw material for bottles. The capacity now targeting more than 5 million bottle by next 3 months target. So that already facility is installed. So that steps have already Reliance has taken to recycle the PET consumer bottles. One more Reliance is doing the recyclability, basically PET waste. We are generating a lot of waste, PET waste during the PET manufacturing, outside, inside also. So we have the plant in Hajira, 65 metric ton plant capacity. There we are taking the PET waste fiber, and that is working from last more than 20 years efficiently. So all the fiber waste, polyester fiber, staple fiber, yarn fiber, we are recycling that PET fiber by using glycolysis method. There we are taking zinc as acetate as a catalyst. And then that is converting in glycolysis section monomer, basically PET waste, we are making PET, low molecular weight. And again, it is going for solid state polymerization. So this also comes under circular economy. So already the work has started, and now people will look for various approaches for a circular economy. So that is one of the examples we are doing at Reliance. Now again, what is the one more challenge is that, if you see, there are global challenges for this bulk chemical, basically, what we are producing. Without that, we can't survive, because we need this chemical. One is ammonia, which is we are producing more than 200 million ton globally. For that, we are using only 140 million ton of the CO2, out of the 50% again CO2 generating. So it is a highly energy consuming process, highly high temperature, high pressure process. All of you know Haber process. But if somebody can come to lower the temperature pressure, then definitely energy will cost will go down, your UOC generation will go down. So that is a real challenge. So people are working, if you see latest references, people are working on different catalysis. So they are targeting at 100 degree room temperature, people are talking. So still scale up and other challenges will be there. So that is one of the most energy consumptive process, and even CO2 generative process. Then followed by ethylene, we are producing ethylene more than 150 million metric ton. That also a high energy intensive process. There also innovation is required. Followed by propylene, 100 million ton, methanol. All these processes are high energy intensive process, top chemicals. So there the innovation is required to reduce the cost and the emissions. Then now people are talking about artificial intelligence and machine learning for catalyst selection and catalyst in catalysis. So basically, if you see, a lot of papers are coming recently on artificial intelligence and developing the practical algorithm, basically, which is a software-based, computer-based resolution, and machine make the your data fast, accurate, and your process time. So one thing, just if you see, people are working on that. This is one example I am showing. The one team has developed the catalyst, basically, which is a NO2, which is based on rhodium and gold particle. So they have designed the various particle from 2 nanometer to 5 nanometer, and they use this AI and machine learning to design the catalyst. So out of that, what they found that the 3 nanometer or 2 nanometer, the highest activity for 3 nanometer. So there are different catalyst descriptors are used to understand this kinetic model. So a lot of understanding is required in that fund, these calculations or DFT molecular modeling calculations, which is helpful basically. But this will helpful to reduce your catalyst development time. If I am developing the catalyst which requires 5 years, but with this AI and machine learning, it may reduce my time by 2 years. So that type of people are working. And now people are going to use that approach in our day-to-day research also. But it will take some time, because this is on just concept base, and people have started the work on that. And now what is the national objective? I talk about energy security, health security, and this environmental security. So what is government plan basically? What they are going to meet there's a demand and how they resolve the challenges. So this is a recent report. If you see national objective of what I talk, improving national India's energy security. So reducing manufacturing import dependency, we are importing more than 17%, reducing carbon emissions. So what is the target basically? Then target has come alternative fuel options, because most of the cost is going import on that oil. So ethanol blending already 10% has government has started. They are taking a lot of initiatives. Now a lot of biofuels, bioethanol plants are coming. Various public sector company, they are mixing the ethanol and it is permitted now. So ethanol will get the boost. So due to that, at least our this import will reduce in some percent. Then we are talking about the CNG. CNG also now coming in the picture in major cities. If you can see all the cars running in Delhi, buses also. So CNG also is helping to reduce these emissions and import. Heavy electrical vehicles, we are talking our target by 2030. Electrical vehicle will come on the road. Some cars has come on the road. Tata has developed Nexon, which is based on electrical vehicle. So now apart from government, initiatives are coming and people are adopting that. And the major target is import, cost, manufacturing, operating. That also has a lot of planning has been made. And you will not believe 100 top companies, chemical companies has involved along with Reliance. So during the discussion now, they are targeting next 3 years plan, how we can reduce the import by even our pharmaceutical drugs, APIs we can manufacture in India. So apart from that, methanol, hydrogen fuel cell also has been included. Apart from this, CNG, you can see right now that we have the CNG around 2000 station, but target is to make 10,000 in the next 2030. Then the hydrogen, this is also promising source. People are looking, hydrogen is gaining a lot of momentum, and due to the global ship regulator investors. And if you see the report, this is a very important report published by Hydrogen Council recently in February. So over 30 countries have been released hydrogen roadmaps and announced more than 200 hydrogen projects. Earlier it was only 50. So in billion, more than 70 billion US dollar investment is there. And around more than 100 industries that has been contributing for this capitalization, and more than 6.5 million employees. So these are the industries basically involved in this hydrogen generation. So Reliance also is there. So people are taking seriously. There are some challenges, storage and transportation. So this is basically plan for production hydrogen. We are producing right now by steam methane reforming. Now target partial oxidation, coal gasification. And then we are going toward biomass, electrolysis, photocatalysis. These are the emerging areas, electrolysis, fuel cell, thermocatalysis. But still, the cost is a major factor. But that also people are working. Right now, if you see, our cost is around 150 rupees per kg for hydrogen by steam or any other method. But by electrolysis is around 300 rupees. But now people are developing the catalyst, which is also based on the catalyst, electrolysis, electrolytic catalyst. So cost is going down. Major than storage, we are working. You will not believe right now, 10 years back, only 10 labs was working on this hydrogen and fuel cell. Now more than 100 labs in India, CSR labs are working on various sector of this energy storage material and hydrogen storage. So storage, like liquid hydrogen, how to transport hydrogen, compress, pipeline for hydrogen, all the people are looking the options. HNGC blending, IOC is working on blending, CNG and hydrogen blending, and they have come up with the petrol pump of that. And then hybrid vehicles, not only single, is a fuel cell, hydrogen hybrid, power generation. Even apart from transportation, they are looking the use in this chemical industry also. If you want hydrogen, high purity hydrogen in automotive industry or electroplating, then they will produce by this method in fertilizer industry also. So that whole planning is going on. Hydrogen economy is not new. In 1970, John Bockris, he mentioned that the hydrogen economy can replace the current hydrocarbon based economy. And this replacement will lead more energy of security and lesser negative impact on the environment. So this will help reduce the emissions. What government is doing, initiatives for this renewable energies. Basically, they have made the separate department for this renewable under DST, high level committee for hydrogen energy map. And many funding energies, government or non-government industry has been involved. And more majorly, they are giving the focus on the more efficient reprogramming process, newer membrane, water splitting reaction. That is major challenge at room temperature. If you split the water, and if you break down this Faraday 1.2 electron, more than electron, then maybe it has a more economical process. Then photo electrochemical process blending, hydrogen gas from biogas. So many CSR labs are involved, and still roadmap identify the technology gap challenges in this large scale hydrogen production. They are doing in phase way. So it is a long way process. What is Reliance is doing? What is Reliance next vision by 2035? Our chairman recently has mentioned in the AGM. So we also want to be opposite to extend new energy. Net zero, they want to go by net carbon zero. So they are also working, plan is already started to work on the build an optimal mix of reliable, clean and affordable energy and storage using solar, wind and batteries. So research will show we are going in that direction for the energy. Then accelerate transition to hydrogen economy, as I mentioned already. So there also we are looking different technologies, viability of the hydrogen. And major important is to develop a portfolio of advanced and specialty material. Next world will be the material world, lightweight, high density, high quality. So different composite, polymer composite material. So that will be the world. And ultimate target is to next generation to complement the climate change. For that, apart from that, the goal is crude oil. Right now we are making crude oil, different chemicals, but targeting direct crude to oil before, without any making any refining. So that also we are targeting. Various chemical we are targeting waste recycling, end product recyclability. So recycling and circular economy will be the focus for next 20 years. Reducing carbon footprint, technology to convert crude and feedstock to monomers and derivatives, and CO2 that we are generating at Reliance outside, that how we can capture and we can make into different chemicals. And then major things are catered to growing demand for materials in India, or Indian demands. And leading an energy company in the carbon neutral world, that is a mission, vision for the company. And just the last slide, how R&D spending on the chemical industries, that is also very important. If you see in last 2018, in the last 10 years, there is a growth now. People are understanding the importance of R&D. And globally also, if you see, China has 16% make the investment, but India still, if you can see, it was 0.7 in 2018. In 2018 now, it has gone to 1.4%. So it is growing. So that is also very important as a research community, because without innovation, we can't sustain. We have to develop our sustainable technology as India. Then only we can sustain in the whole market. Last is the government vision, basically. Along with that, whole energy, health, and environmental. This is a government vision. People are working. You can see whole report of the government of India is released. Economic liberalization that has happened in 1991. After that, Make in India approach has come in 2014. Now we are talking in Atmanirbhar Bharat in terms of our reduce the local dependency, basically. And then self-reliant India by reducing import dependency, focusing on Make India. Make in India, make for world. Anything manufactured in India by domestic and MNC. So already, if you see, the PLI scheme has started by government, production link incentives, which is worth about 1 lakh more than 45,000 crore, which is focused on the in-house manufacture of battery, auto component, because these are the required thing in the future to make our sustainability and reduce the cost of the process. So the government also is taking a lot of initiatives. Companies are public sector also are taking a lot of initiatives to fulfill this demand. And lastly, just I want to, as per my experience, just share what are the critical success factors, basically, when you work on any project or anywhere. I will say it applicable to not only company or industry, it applicable to your college student or university. Really, if you want to make successful in any profession, so there are few qualities which are very, very important that I learned during my last 20 years. So one thing, teamwork is very important. One person can't do anything. If you realize that at early stage, really will grow like anything. So single person, he has a lot of ideas, but there is no use, because if you can't take that idea forward, you need a people, you need a critical discussion. For that, you need teamwork. In that teamwork, once you are agree, you are ready to do teamwork, then transference. You have to be transferred with the people. Whatever the thing in your mind, if you want to develop or implement anything, small thing in college or university, if transference is not there, trust will not there. People will not have the trust on you. So to develop the trust in your team, that is very important. If your team of 10 people, 20 people, if you are in university, college. So to make the transparency, trust building is very important to develop any big thing or implement. Then collaboration. In the current world, you want to collaborate with many, many universities, many colleges. If you think, no, I will only do, it is impossible, because everything, you can't invest for that. And today, nobody will do that. So for that, it is very important to collaborate with different people, different agencies, and to deliver your project on time. Then positive attitude. You have to be always positive in your work, in your approach. When you are positive, then every one second person will be positive. If you are negative thinking, then the ultimate negative thinking will start. So that is very important, positivity towards your work, towards your profession. Because whatever the work we are doing for society, we are doing for our country. So, and we are doing for our growth. But it is very important to do the sincerely that job. So positive attitude is one of the important quality, I will say. Then customer requirement, what your customer want, basically. Everybody has customer. If you see, everybody, if I am running any college, students are my customer. So how I can fulfill my customer? That is very important. Students, they are future of my college or my country. How I can develop for tomorrow's future? How I can develop whole their personality, not only technical competency. There are other competencies are required. So every stage customer is important. I am working for the customer because if I am going to the market, I will want the best. For that best, I will go excellence. So whatever I have developed, I should be accepted. So for that, our mindset should be customer based. It is not like if I'm selling some product, which is customer based. If I'm working in any region, if you are giving some consultancy to any company, so consultant is your customer, right? For student, customer is their future. They are investing a lot of time for their future. So they have to work like that. And they have to adopt all these things. Then only you will be successful. Otherwise, you will be in the middle. You will not success in your profession. Apart from that, what are the personal qualities that is very, very important? One is a commitment. You have to be committed for your work. You have to be commitment for your delivery. If you are doing some work, and if you have targeted some time, I will complete in 1 week. So we have to complete, because that based on the commitment, people will judge you. People will have trust on that. Otherwise, if you commit and if you do a job, you are after 1 month, nobody will come back to you. You will lose your identity. So commitment is very, very important. Apart from passion for work, you should be passionate to do something. Passionate to do something for myself, my team, my family. I can't change. You have to do like that. I can only change my future. Nobody can change my future. So if you work with that passion, then you will grow like anything. Dedication. If you decide anything to do, then completely you have to dedicate. Not only you, your whole team has to dedicate. You have to mix that atmosphere. So leadership quality is very important. Your leader is very important. Without leadership, it is impossible. So leader has to motivate his team. He should not be partial. He should be open. He should be transparent. Then only he can build the confidence of the people. So he first leader should be dedicated. Then his whole team will be dedicated. So dedication is one of the important quality, I will say, on personal basis. One more quality is adaptability in new atmosphere. Today you are working in maybe Shivaji College. Tomorrow you will go somewhere else. Then you have to adapt that situation. Then will be successful. Otherwise, I can't adopt the people change. I can't adopt the atmosphere change. Then it is very difficult. It is very difficult to you to survive in the future, because the world is changing very fast. So you have to adopt the change. Then only you will be successful. And most important, you have to respect the people, irrespective of junior and senior. Whether junior for 2 years, it is a fresh people, because he has a lot of ideas. It doesn't mean I am 20 years experience. I am working, but I never consider if new person is there. You have to listen carefully, because he has a lot of energy. He has a lot of knowledge. He is coming with new knowledge. So you have to respect his knowledge and respect his views as a human being. Definitely important, and most important is the appreciation. You have to appreciate the people. When somebody does the job, for you or to work the team, then you have to appreciate the people for the right work. And that appreciation is so genuine. It should not be fake. If you appreciate the people genuinely, then people will respect that appreciation. So appreciation and motivation is very important. Anybody who is working in the profession, and if you want to motivate the people, I think that is the best way to appreciate the people for their work on the right time. So what I find, that these are the important qualities which is required to make yourself successful in any profession. And this some of the concluding remarks just I want to put due to time, just I will not go in detail. Like alternative energy, already I talked solar, wind and cars, that will be the future of that, produce or import oil. Then expansion of the manufacturing facility for pharmaceutical, that already is actually has started. So then it will be opportunity for job creation also. Many jobs will be created if we develop the manufacturing facility in India. So all the pharma sector, chemistry, biochemistry, or pharma people, job opportunity will be there. CO2 emission control, definitely. Novel VOC destruction technology still are required at lower temperature. Right now the temperature is 250, but if somebody come up with 200 degree temperature, that is definitely will be invited and will be useful for industry. So this type of research are definitely useful for industry. Chemical R&D spending is progressing, but still need more investment. And then finally, if you see the focused partnership, people talk about academic and industry partnership, but that should be focused. What industry wants basically, what academics want. So that research, I think academics should do. Even I will suggest in syllabus also, it should be regularly viewed where we are going. So that type of circular economy, that type of syllabus should be included from BSc level. Then people understand what research I am doing, why, what is the chemistry, what is the use of this chemistry. If I don't know the use of chemistry, then there is no meaning. I will not do that with that passion. And most important, skill development. So whatever the skill I am developing today, BMSc, BSc people, so I have to develop for the next level job or any challenges. So how I'm developing as a college, university or institute. So that is also our job. There is a faculty job. So I think these are the challenges, and I think futuristic, I think I will say, can be fulfill our requirement. Finally, I would like to thank our group R&D Chemical Synthesis and Catalysis, where I'm working. And this is our R&D center in Mumbai, where I'm working. So this is a very big R&D center. Reliance has made more than 500 crore investment in the R&D, and 300 scientists are working on different cutting edge technologies to develop what I have shown just 1%, but various technologies we are working. Apart from that, we have R&D at Vadodara, also very old R&D, IPCL R&D, which has started in 1976. Then Jamnagar, we have R&D, and this is different project we are working, Hajira Patra Ganga. And I would like to acknowledge R&D management and the Department of Chemistry, Dr. Mamta Sangole, Sharui Thorat, Dr. Korpe, and the whole chemistry department. I want to acknowledge for inviting me. And just I want to say, opportunity emerges from the challenges. Success follow the brave who embrace the challenges. So success is in your hand, not anybody's hand. Only you are the person who can change your future. That I want to say. And this is my group, basically. In Mumbai, we have the scientific pool, various scientists, PhD, MSc, some are the engineers. So this is the group in the Mumbai. This is in the Baroda. We have the pool scientific. We are doing all pilot plant testing. This is our R&D head, Dr. R.V. Jastra, who is leading our group. And various scientists are there. We are working very closely together. Our teams are there. Whole approach is teamwork, not a single, whatever I have shown, whole this is a teamwork we have done. Single person can't develop any technology. So finally, just on these occasions, I am talking, and this is my alma mater college, Shivaji College. And I did my MSc from there. So I have a lot of respect and a lot of memories from that college. And I learned many things, basically, whatever today I am there due to my mentors and gurus. I will say they have made the catalyst in my life, role of the catalyst. So it has started from Professor Radhesham Pampalia at Junior College when I was studying my 12th. And he was a very passionate person I have seen towards the chemistry. So he has helped me to learn the chemistry and passionate about the chemistry. So after that, after completing my 12th, I did my BSc from Rajasthan College, Washim. There also the faculty, Dr. Toshniwal, and all staffs, they have given me a lot of opportunity to learn the chemistry practicals and their knowledge they have shared. And then after that, I came to Shivaji College, Sri Shivaji College, Akola Department of Chemistry, there in 1999-2000. So I interacted with Professor Bhagade. He is very old physical chemistry. He was teaching Professor Kale, Professor Bhagat. Even Bhadange sir also was always motivating me on any occasion, whenever I go to college, and whole staff basically. And now the main important person who is responsible, I think whole department, and who is a really motivator for me also, Professor S.P. Deshmukh, who is a real contributor for chemistry department, who has put his whole heart to develop the department, and who has really changed the brand of the chemistry department of Akola, I will say. So really, I had a lot of respect for the sir. And from last 20 years, I had a good interaction with sir. Always, if I go to Akola, always I talk with him. So apart from that, now new generation, Dr. Korpe, who is leading the group, along with Dr. Mamta, Dr. Sharu, they are taking a lot of effort to make this department more vibrant and more visible. And last, the Padma Shri Professor G.D. Yadav, where I did my PhD, that changed the world in ICT, where I got additional opportunities to learn the catalysis world. He has shown me the world of catalysis. With that time, I was not knowing more about catalysis, but the real world of the catalysis he has shown me, and he has guided me for my PhD. Due to him today, all the peoples, along with these people, my friends, family, and my colleagues, they are helping me. I am learning every day. It is not a one-day process. Every day I am learning new things from all the peoples. So that is only possible to sustain me as of now. Thank you. Thank you very much for your time and patience.
Dr. Sharad, we are really privileged to have you as a speaker. Actually, you have explained briefly each and everything what is actually happening at industrial level with the help of catalysts. So it was really informative as well as instructive practical talk for our student. Dr. Sharad, you wanted to talk something about you. So over to you, Sharad ma'am.
Yes. Good afternoon, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So that was a very extensive and exhaustive.
Shuru ma'am.
Shuru ma'am, you are paused.
I'm not audible, ma'am.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. So that was a very extensive and exhaustive summary given by our speaker, Dr. Sharad Lande. All of us must have got an idea from his profile. He has a very ambitious personality. He is very hardworking, talented, and focused personality, as also very motivated. He has given us a complete glimpse of the functioning of Reliance Industries, wherein a very by Dr. Sharad Lande, given us valuable information on the role of heterogeneous catalysis, especially the industrial catalyst, preparation, technologies, and contribution of chemical industry to society. He has also explained to us about the use of noble metal, which can be used as catalyst, such as platinum, palladium, silver, gold, rhodium. He has also given us extensive information about the catalyst characterization, the stability of catalyst in the synthesis of green chemicals for sustainable future. Because all of us know that there is an increased requirement for more eco-friendly technologies for various industries. So this concept of sustainable technology proposes a model shifting from traditional concepts to new technologies that reduces waste at source and avoids the use of toxic and hazardous materials. So the role of catalyst today is indispensable and strategic. So this was very well explained by Dr. Sharad Lande. He has also emphasized on the issues like health security, that is the use of catalyst for drug synthesis. He has also explained to us about the commitments under Paris Agreement 2030, also explained to us about the increasing energy demand and expressed concern that leads to CO2 emission and other environmental problems. He has also explained to us about the volatile organic compounds from industrial sector. So to limit the use and the emission of volatile organic compounds in research initiatives, so what could be the catalytic materials for the removal of VOCs? He has also explained to us about the wastewater treatment. All these are included in R&D innovations and technologies of the Reliance Industries. He has also explained to us about the future perspectives for sustainability, which requires many challenges. He has explained to us, actually, I think so, this was the lecture which could be divided into two or three lectures, as he had lots of knowledge to us for sharing. Then he has also explained to us about the roadmap for a new decade, that is explained very well about how we can switch from linear to circular economy. Then the concept of artificial intelligence, which is very well known today, and machine learning for catalyst selection. Then he has also given us the knowledge about the national objectives, impact of alternative power trains, and the use of hydrogen as an alternative energy source. Then lastly, he has explained to us about the new growth opportunities which are needed to cater to add to the problems. And the most important thing which he explained today was the requirement of teamwork, collaboration, excellence, positive attitude, transparency, customer requirements, which all of the students must have a note. Then he has also explained about focusing about partnership issues between the academic and chemical industries. Really, sir, this is the need of the hour, that the academic institutions should have the collaboration with the industries right from framing up of the syllabus so that our students are benefited. So I think so, this was a very extensive and exhaustive survey and a very good summary given by our speaker, Dr. Sharad Lande. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us today. Thank you once again, and I think meet towards the further lessons from you. Thank you, sir. Over to Mamta. Madam.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I would like to thank Dr. Ganeshpuri also. Just I have seen him here. He joined. I worked with him for last and long time. Thank you for joining.
Sir, I joined in the beginning, actually. Hello,
sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
hello?
Yes.
Am I audible?
Okay, now we will open our session for questions answer, because even faculty as well as students have questions regarding your session. So we will have few questions. So I will call Devil Deshmukh for with his question.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Hello. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, for a wonderful talk. Actually, a very knowledgeable session was there. So I would like to ask you two questions. The first one, you have mentioned about the in situ characterization, right? Comparing the homogeneous as well as heterogeneous catalysis, which one is more convenient at the industrial level for in situ characterization? That is my first question. And the second one is, you have mentioned about the a chiral catalysis. We can see. So, is it possible to get a stereo controlled product using the nano catalyst? That is the heterogeneous nano catalyst.
Yeah. Thank you, Dhaval, for your nice question. Regarding first question, definitely this in situ characterization. Right now, people are exploring more for heterogeneous catalysis compared to homogeneous catalysis, because whole chemistry happen on the surface in heterogeneous catalysis. So your catalyst active site should be active to convert the reactant into product. So when this reactant convert into product, there are various intermediate form on the catalyst surface. So to understand the catalyst property, which are the oxygen states are responsible for this intermediate formation. So then we are doing in situ like XRD or XPS. All the characterization we are doing. So definitely it is more viable for heterogeneous compared to homogeneous, because homogeneous is going in the liquid phase and which is dissolving in the reaction media. So right now people references are there. They are preferring heterogeneous catalyst. Okay. This is your first question. Second question regarding chiral synthesis. Yes, chiral synthesis also, if you want to make chiral compound, any chiral molecule, there are two strategy. One is you should have chiral ligand, and otherwise you should have the chiral catalyst. You should reactant. Two things you can make the chiral compound. But heterogeneous also, yes. Homogeneous, yeah, people are there. Palladium based catalyst. Heterogeneous also, people are making
that. Hello. But my basic question is that, is it possible with the simple nanocatalyst, simple heterogeneous nanocatalyst, means without loading or
yes,
something like that? Okay. So we can achieve the chiral possible product using that also.
Yes.
Okay.
Even well, we have made the chiral geolites also in the lab, the solid material also, we have made the chirals to change
okay
the morphology. Yes, that is also possible.
Okay,
yes,
okay.
Thank you,
sir. Thank you so much.
One of our student, Talia Fatima, wanted to ask something to you. So, Talia, please go ahead.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Talia Fatima. First of all, a very heartwarming thanks to Dr. Sarad Landi, sir, for such an enchanting and praiseworthy seminar. We are totally glad to be part of this session. It was a detailed informative information was given by you in a basic form, from we can really understand it in a basic language. As it is really important, as we are totally suffering from severe environmental issues, and this type of catalysis and its work can be, can be used for its recovery of a mother earth.
Can you repeat the question? Mamta, what is your question?
Talia, please repeat, because even I am not listening your question. I am not able to listen you.
Yes, ma'am. It is really totally
your voice is not coming.
Yeah, otherwise you can type in the chat box. You can type also.
Meanwhile, even Akansha also wanted to ask you something. Akansha, please, you can ask. Are you there?
Yes, good afternoon, sir. This is Akansha.
Okay.
Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, yes. Am I audible? Please go ahead. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, as you mentioned, there are that metals are used as a catalyst. My question is that how the natural compound like flowers, etc., are used to synthesize the catalyst? Means, what is their role?
No, actually, anything, if you want to use a catalyst, it should have certain properties. Like in homogeneous catalyst, if there is any metal you are using, some metals are there that can act as a catalyst. Like I will give you a simple example. Soil also can be used as a catalyst. If you take a clay is a soil. So, because in that, what is the enrich are aluminium are there, ions are there. So that can also as a catalyst. So that compound should be there. If you take, I understand your question. If I go with flowers and natural way, that already catalysts are there, but the way of the catalyst is different. Maybe in that process, you can use as a biocatalyst. If some enzymes are there, active enzymes are there, that can be used for some processes.
And so some nanoparticles are also get synthesis by using the various natural products like flowers,
yes, yes.
Extract,
yeah, yeah. Yes, yes, very true. You can control the nanoparticle size basically. If I'm taking palladium metal, and if I'm combining with the natural products basically, natural plants. So where there I'm controlling the platinum particle size because there are also organic molecules are there. They are interacting with my palladium metals and they are controlling my shape and size, which is required by my catalysis. So some of the reactions I am doing in that way also. So there are references and academics people are doing. They are using, even they are using this plant and extraction or reduce the metal also because some of the hydrogen will be generated during the process. So that is also possible. That is possible. Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir, one basic question again, I want to ask, as a student, how could we start our career in the field of the research? I just wanted to know from you, how you start your work?
Yeah, I think this is a good question. Basically, to start the career, first you should have the passion to do something. Yeah, I want to make my career in chemistry or any areas. You have to fix your area and then you have to build your knowledge basically. What is going on your around? Not only if I'm doing BSc or MSc, that is enough for my development of my skills. So one thing is you have to build a technical competency. Second thing, I can give a separate seminar on that, but anyway, I will briefly explain. Secondly, you have to develop your personality. Basically, confidence you have to build, how you are confident about your knowledge, how your qualities teamwork, what I mentioned that also qualities are very important to sustain. And learning, that I will say, every day you have to learn something new. If you adopt that thing, my mission is that every day I will learn, even if I'm on holiday, I will read something. So if you build these qualities in yourself, then definitely you can successful in any area. It is not difficult to get the job, I'm telling. A lot of jobs are there, but jobs are there for the right people. If you're really passionate, you will get the job.
Okay, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Dr. Sharad, you may be happy because Ganesh Pure sir wanted to say something. So Ganesh Pure sir, welcome once again, and you can say over to you.
Yeah, Ganesh Pure sir is there. Yeah.
Ganesh Pure sir.
Yes, Ganesh Pure sir, please.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. Sir is saying he had some problem with his audio, so we can resume our program as per schedule. So next question, Narayan Shinde wanted to ask one question to you. Sir Narayan, please.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Sir, I wanted to ask a question that if we want to do a PhD, so in catalytic chemistry, so which topic should we use? Sir, which topic is relevant?
See, in catalysis, there is a very vast area. So in catalysis also, if you want to do homogeneous, heterogeneous, like metal supported, okay. In pharmaceutical also, a lot of catalysts are used. That is one area. Now people are talking about the electrocatalysis, photocatalysis, that is the future field. So I will say if you do any research, but if that passion is there, that involvement is there, then you'll be successful. That is not restriction to any topic, but only you have to involve yourself. Yeah, I will go in depth in that area and I will build my knowledge, and any forum, I can justify that knowledge. So any area, I think it is welcome. It is not like that if you are working in some matter supported, because that skill you have to build. Ultimately in PhD, what you will build your skills in 3 to 4 years. So whatever you like, that you go. If you like some heterogeneous catalysis, you go with that. You build your knowledge on that area. You read the information and then you can do the research. It is not like that. If you do the research, you learn more opportunity. I will see right now, earlier the trend was like that. Only organic chemist. But if you see right now, there are many jobs for other physical chemistry, analytical chemistry, biochemistry, apart from organic chemistry. So organic chemistry is there, is evergreen field. But there are specific jobs. So there only your skill and competence will be required. So I will suggest that whatever you like in catalysis, that you decide first. And whatever the important, like petrochemical, refinery, and biochemicals, biocatalysis, that you choose. And you can do the PhD and you can start your career.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Actually, I'm very happy to announce that the student who has asked question to you, he has passed GATE examination 2021. So we just wanted to congratulate him. Hello?
Yes, congratulations. And wish you all the best. Yeah. Congratulations. Whatever you do, you do with your sincere effort, you will be successful.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
We had received the news. Our two students, Narayan Chitre as well as Sadia Saman, both of you has cleared GATE examination.
Okay, very good, very good. All the best to both of you.
Okay, okay. Anyone from the student wanted to ask question or... Kumbhalkar ma'am, do you have any questions from the YouTube live?
Yes, ma'am.
You can read the questions for our speaker.
Yes, ma'am. There is one question, sir, from Arya Bise. Is there is any type of catalyst required for the production of any type of paint?
Paints,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. Yeah. Because, see, if you making the paint composition, if you see, all basically paints are based on the emulsion and polymerization. So, if you do any polymerization, definitely, if you use the catalyst, first you should know your starting material, what starting material you are taking. What is the molecular weight you are targeting? So based on the molecular weight, you can design your catalyst. And all these in the paints and polymers, the catalyst are homogeneous catalyst. That is required in PPM level. Just you have to add in PPM level and that you'll get the product. You don't need to recover from that paint. So paint and polymer. So that is possible. But before that, what type of paint you are making in the current paint industries, they are using different catalysts. But based on their molecular weight, dispersibility, and the properties, then the catalyst can be modified. But there, I will suggest mostly the homogeneous based catalyst are used, which is derived the polymerization reaction, iridium based catalyst or ruthenium based catalyst. But the quantity will be very, very less. You don't need to recover from that paint or polymer.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I can see one question in the chat box, and he may be your colleague.
Yes, I think one question I am seeing from Dr. Amar Jadhav. Amar Jadhav.
Yes, sir. I am here, sir.
Good afternoon. How are you?
I am fine, sir. Actually, my students are there also with in this webinar. RIABC is actually my student. Sir, one question actually I want to ask you about. Actually, my PhD work was on the modification of hydrotalcide. So, what are the preliminary criteria to modify hydrotalcide? So, how we can select metals? Now, I have selected metal like zinc, titanium. So, which are the primary criteria to select metals for modification of any catalyst?
Yeah, good question. The hydrotalcide basically are aluminium, magnesium, composite mixed oxide metal. And in Reliance R&D also, we are using this material for various applications. So here, basically, we are using for adsorption application because the sandwich gap is there, structure is there. So we can adsorb few chemicals like chloride remol or something like that. But if you want to do any catalyst, basically, metal, so based on your applications, if you are doing oxidation reaction, so definitely then the nature of the like chromium or manganese or that type of catalyst we have to incorporate and you have to do the oxidation. This hydrotalcide you can use as a catalyst support also because it has a tetrahedral or octahedral sites also, aluminum hecant sites also. So that metal you can entrap in that and you can do a catalyst very well. And the major advantage of hydrotalcide is as a thermal stability also. It has very good thermal stability. So that can use as a higher temperature. So it is a people are have done also palladium, platinum. And in our here also we are modifying that by different metal. But again, based on the reaction, if I am to do hydrogenation, then I am modifying with the help of palladium with different complexing agent. So there I will get the proper distribution of my palladium on hydrotalcide. So I can use the whole coverage of hydrotalcide. But advantage is that the basicity. That basicity also I will get the advantage of the hydrotalcide. So that already we are doing. So it is always, again, based on your the application, which type of reaction you are doing. So it is viable option. Even people are talking supported hydroxide also by doing different mix oxide as well as ionic liquid they are using. So there has potential. Hydroxide is a potential material in the industry. Yes.
And one more question, sir. Actually, so for my synthesis of catalyst, we are having different methods like precipitation method, Sol-gel method, combustion synthesis method. So randomly, if I tell to my students, then which methods I will I have to tell them to go for the manufacturing of catalyst first. So which one is better as compared to others?
Yeah, I think every technique, you can do a PhD on each technique, whatever you mentioned, for precipitation, noble metal, because method is based on the what type of metal you are synthesizing. If I am synthesizing zinc oxide or iron oxide metal, so then co-precipitation technique, where the bulk composition are required, like 30% cobalt or 30% zinc, there I will go by co-precipitation technique. But if I want to load a few quantity of the material, few percent of the material, like 1%, 0.1%, then I will go with this impregnation method technique. So if I want to make the mixed oxide catalyst, then I will go the co-precipitation technique. But if I want to do noble metal catalyst metal, then I will go with the metal impregnation method.
Okay, so in industry, sir, which one is common?
Both co-precipitation also in Gevalet synthesis, we are synthesizing the large quantity of Gevalet by co-precipitation. But oxidation catalyst, what I have shown, that we are using a metal impregnation method. So both the technique are equally used in the industry.
Thank you, sir. And very good presentation. I have seen from start, sir. If possible, please send your presentation to participants.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely, it will add value to us. Thank you, sir.
Yes. Thank you for your time. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So there is one question by Nikhil Akhil Nakhate, sir, Bajaj College of Science, Wardha. What is the reason for the sudden rise in the price of palladium as compared to platinum?
Yeah, I think, yes, I agree with the question is very right. And yesterday we had discussion on this question.
Yes, sir.
Actually, what happened is a very good question because we are using platinum in our catalyst that I showed, platinum. We are not putting the palladium. We have the one computer catalyst there, platinum palladium is there. So due to that, due to increase in the palladium cost, the catalyst cost is going up. So yes. Then we try to avoid to use the platinum in your catalyst. But definitely, role also is important. We have to understand the role of the catalyst. So as much as if you can replace palladium with copper and other metal, then the catalyst can be cost effective. So yes, it is true. Palladium cost is going up. Suddenly, it is almost double. Earlier, it was 1:1. Platinum palladium almost or 2,000 rupees per gram or 2,000 rupees per gram. But now it is going double. So definitely, it is a concern for the industry where we are using the palladium. So I think best way to develop the chemistry with using the composite material or bimetal catalyst, where we can mix the palladium with platinum, copper, silver, and then we can do the chemistry. So I think that is also important question in terms of the catalyst cost. Yeah, I agree.
Sir, is there a change in the automobile sector to use the platinum replaced by palladium?
No, still car converter, still a lot of work is going on to replace the car converter at exhaust catalyst. Still there is a platinum, palladium and rhodium, because the catalyst has to be work at that temperature. So I have shown that Tamandan temperature. So the catalyst will not stable at that temperature. So somebody has to develop the process which can be oxidized at lower temperature. So that is a real challenge for catalyst researcher. If anybody is working in the catalyst, so we have the open challenge, even from Reliance also, if somebody has the catalyst which can oxidize this VOC at less than 100 degree temperature, so there is a lot of potential. So I will say, I think researcher can put a lot of efforts and you can do innovation in that. How I can reduce the car converter temperature from 600 to 200, 300. Then maybe if you can see, silver can also do the job, copper can also do the job, but major challenge is the stability of that catalyst at that temperature. It will get sintered out.
Yeah, yeah.
So it will be mobile at that temperature. So as of now, only that are the feasible metals, platinum, palladium, and rhodium. But yeah, innovation is going on. If somebody come up with the composite material, definitely it will replace. Yeah, people are modifying the ceramic membrane also, ceramic support, this monolith. So they are trying to reduce the quantity of the metal, reduce the cost of the converter.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Anjan, you have questions?
There is one more question from YouTube, sir. Okay. Hello?
Yes, please.
There is a question from YouTube, sir, asked by Samiksha Minde. Why big companies who's making profits in crores but not concerned about how to make environment clean and healthy by researching and another way by not making that kind of product which harm environment?
Yeah. I think very good question. If you see this global emissions and waste generating throughout the world. So if you want to make something, definitely that's, I thought, linear economy. That's we are still in very processes. We are working on linear economy based. There a side product generation is there. And if I'm developing some chemistry, so only chemistry can resolve that issue of the VOC or the emissions or the waste generation. So chemistry only can give the solution, not other thing solution will come. And that is your question. Definitely we are working, but that is not so easy also, because at larger scale, it is not that solution should be sustainable. So what happened? Few things work at lab scale. That is very easy, microbial and other thing. But if you go on scale up scale, then the performance and the cost. So it will be cost effective also. Like if I'm making 10 rupees in my product, and if I'm giving some product which is more dealing with more waste, so then it will be not cost effective process. So then the industry will not make that product. But at least now, if you see the PCB, pollution control board, they are very stringent nowadays. So if you put any new process, then they will come and they will ask you how much waste will be generated. So as of now, what happened has happened. But now if anybody has to put the chemical plant, so he has to give whole concept and a whole idea where the waste will go, how will it treat. So in Reliance also, we are generating this wastewater. So we are not allowed to this wastewater to send in the rivers and anywhere. We have to deal in-house only. Then only we'll get the permission. So a lot of money has spent on that, but still, it has to become on the larger scale, because small scale industry, it will be not cost effective. As you said, profit making. So that also happened. But if you see the report on National Pollution Control Board, so they have given the red mark, red. So those, they are generating a lot of waste. They are now under red zone. So now in Pune itself, there are 250 companies which are under red zone. So they have given some ultimatum now. In next 6 months, if you don't come up with a solution, then you have to stop your plant. So government is nowadays very stringent. So maybe after 3 years or 2 years, you can see the changes now, because we are also seeing that changes. That is the reason our MD's vision, Mukesh Ambani's vision, by 2035, we have to be carbon neutral. So now already work has started, but it takes time, because on larger scale, the technology should be sustainable, that I talk. So if sustainable technology will come, then definitely we will deal. But already work has started at that level, but he has committed that we will be carbon neutral. We will not emit anything by 2035. So for that, maybe we'll generate hydrogen, we'll generate electric vehicle or we'll generate the battery, new batteries, where the chemical formations for such type of chemical will be less. Otherwise, whatever we are producing, we can recycle. That strategy we have to follow. So that is really burning question. And people really are working on that. People are not working and they are not informed. If somebody is creating a pollution, they are informed by the authorities now. It is not the situation what has happened in last 20 years back. But now people are very careful about that. So yes, I agree with you. That is there.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
There are lots of questions in chat box. If allowed, time allowed, then I will ask. Ma'am?
I think I should stop now. We have covered almost all questions.
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
So,
hey, madam, if you have any question, just you can send me the email. I have my email ID with Dr. Yes. Mamta. So just you can send me an email. I will respond on that. My contact details has been given. That is not in chat box. I will put my email ID. You can send me an email.
And some students are asking for the PDF if possible.
Yes. Yes, yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay,
thank you.
I will invite Taleha Fatima for her feedback.
Hello.
Taleha, are you there?
Ma'am, I'm audible. Thank you, sir.
Yes, you are.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir, for this praiseworthy seminar. You have given us a detailed information regarding catalysis and its basics. This seminar has enabled us to understand how to work under this field for the sustainable chemistry. From each and every point, you have showed your own views from industrial view and answer each and every question. Thank you so much. The seminar was really excellent and praiseworthy. Hope to attend further seminars. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Hope you learn something from this seminar. It will be useful for you. And it will motivate, at least if I motivate 10% of the people, I will say I have done my job.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay. On behalf of our college and department, we want to hand over the certificate of appreciation to Dr. Sharad Lande. So this is your certificate for appreciation. So now I invite Dr. Zamir to propose vote of thanks.
Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm audible, ma'am?
Yes, yes, you are.
Okay, thank you so much. First of all, I will just quote one quote. First of all, a chemistry without catalysis would be a sword without a handle, a light without a brilliance, and a bell without a sound. A very good afternoon to one and all. I am Zamir Sheikh, Faculty of Chemistry from Sri Shivaji College of Arts, Commerce and Science, Akola. I deem it a great honor, privilege, and gives immense pleasure to propose the vote of thanks on this memorable occasion. Let me first of all start by giving glory to Almighty God for making today's occasion resounding and success. Our inspiration, Dr. Panjabrao Deshmukh, on the behalf of Department of Chemistry, first and foremost, I thank our special guest, Dr. Sharad Lande, sir, Assistant Vice President, R&D Reliance Industries Limited, Mumbai, who despite his busy schedule has found time to grace this occasion. Definitely, sir, our students will benefit from this wonderful and energetic lecture in the field of catalysis and their applications toward chemistry. I would like to thank our well-wisher, beloved, respected principal, Dr. R.M. Bisse, sir, for his support and commitment. We are grateful to our respected head of the department, Professor G.V. Korpe, sir, for his words of encouragement and able guidance has always encouraged us. I thank him for his kindness, his interest, his hospitality, and continued support. I would like to thank our respected Dr. Ashish Raut, sir, IQAC coordinator of the college, who actively participated and always ready to help. My heart left thanks to head of the various department and faculties for their valuable contribution, guidance, and encouragement in all our efforts. I would like to thank the event in charge, Dr. M.T. Sangole ma'am and Dr. S.M. Thorat ma'am, who has worked hard to ensure that this occasion becomes a memorable success. I would like to thank our first alumni of department, respected Ganesh Pura sir, Vice President of Petroleum Industries of Reliance Limited. I would like to thank our technical team from the Computer Science Department, Anita Dubey, ma'am, Assistant Professor, and Rupali Kare, ma'am, Assistant Professor, for his kind support. I would like to thank Dr. Akhil Vithal Rao Nakhate sir, Assistant Professor, Bajaj College of Science, Wardha, for your presence. I owe special gratitude to the teaching and non-teaching staff of my department. Last but not the least, I thank to all the students of chemistry department from UG and PG, from our college and from outside the college, beloved audience, for making this occasion as a grand success. Once again, I thank one and all present here. Finally, I leave you this inspiring quote by Benjamin Franklin: an investment in the knowledge pays the best interest. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. I would also like to thank all your efforts and appreciation and organizing this wonderful seminar, and got the opportunity to interact all the students. I also learn many things from you, all of you, by the interaction, and definitely we'll continue this interaction in our future also. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I especially want to acknowledge the presence of few alumni of our department, Dr. Rucha Purani, Dr. Anvita. So thank you for joining us, Rucha and Anvita. Okay, so with the permission of our chair, I would like to say our program is over.